The Law of Success, Lesson 11, Accurate Thought. You can do it if you believe you can. This is, at one and the same time, the most important, the most interesting, and the most difficult to present lesson of this entire course on the Law of Success. It is important because it deals with a principle which runs through the entire course. It is interesting for the same reason. It is difficult to present for the reason that it will carry the average student far beyond the boundary line of his common experiences and into a realm of thought in which he is not accustomed to dwell. Unless you study this lesson with an open mind, you will miss the very keystone to the arch of this course, and without this stone you can never complete your temple of success. This lesson will bring you a conception of thought which may carry you far above the level to which you have risen by the evolutionary processes to which you have been subjected in the past. And for this reason, you should not be disappointed if at first reading you do not fully understand it. Most of us disbelieve that which we cannot understand, and it is with knowledge of this human tendency in mind that I caution you against closing your mind if you do not grasp all that is in this lesson at the first reading. For thousands of years, men made ships of wood, and of nothing else. They used wood because they believed that it was the only substance that would float. But that was because they had not yet advanced far enough in their thinking process to understand the truth that steel will float, and that it is far superior to wood for the building of ships. They did not know that anything could float which was lighter than the amount of water it displaced, and until they learned of this great truth, they went on making ships of wood. Until some 25 years ago, most men thought that only the birds could fly, but now we know that man can not only equal the flying of the birds, but he can excel it. Men did not know until quite recently that the great open void known as the air is more alive and more sensitive than anything that is on the earth. They did not know that the spoken word would travel through the ether with the speed of a flash of lightning, without the aid of wires. How could they know this when their minds had not been unfolded sufficiently to enable them to grasp it? The purpose of this lesson is to aid you in so unfolding and expanding your mind that you will be able to think with accuracy. For this unfoldment will open to you a door that leads to all the power you will need in completing your temple of success. All through the preceding lessons of this course, you observed that we have dealt with principles which anyone could easily grasp and apply. You will also observe that these principles have been so presented that they will lead to success as measured by material wealth. This seemed necessary for the reason that to most people, the word success and the word money are synonymous terms. Obviously, the previous lessons of this course were intended for those who look upon worldly things and material wealth as being all that there is to success. Presenting the matter in another way, I was conscious of the fact that the majority of the students of this course would feel disappointed if I pointed out to them a roadway to success that leads through other than the doorways of business and finance and industry. For it is a matter of common knowledge that most men want success that is spelled $UCCE$. Very well. Let those who are satisfied with this standard of success have it. But some there are who will want to go higher up the ladder in search of success which is measured in other than material standards, and it is for their benefit in particular that this and the subsequent lessons of this course are intended. Accurate thought involves two fundamentals, which all who indulge in it must observe. First, to think accurately, you must separate facts from mere information. There is much information available to you that is not based upon facts. Second, you must separate facts into two classes, namely, the important and the unimportant, or the relevant and the irrelevant. Only by so doing can you think clearly. All facts which you can use in the attainment of your definite chief aim are important and relevant. All that you cannot use are unimportant and irrelevant. It is mainly the neglect of some to make this distinction which accounts for the chasm which separates so widely people who appear to have equal ability and who have had equal opportunity. Without going outside of your own circle of acquaintances, you can point to one or more persons who have had no greater opportunity than you have had, and who appear to have no more and perhaps less ability than you, who are achieving far greater success. And you wonder why. Search diligently, and you will discover that all such people have acquired the habit of combining and using the important facts which affect their line of work. Far from working harder than you, they are perhaps working less and with greater ease. By virtue of their having learned the secret of separating the important facts from the unimportant, they have provided themselves with a sort of fulcrum and lever with which they can move with their little fingers loads that you cannot budge with the entire weight of your body. The person who forms the habit of directing his attention to the important facts out of which he is constructing his temple of success thereby provides himself with a power which may be likened to a trip hammer which strikes a 10-ton blow as compared to a tack hammer which strikes a 1-pound blow. If these similes appear to be elementary, you must keep in mind the fact that some of the students of this course have not yet developed the capacity to think in more complicated terms, and to try to force them to do so would be the equivalent of leaving them hopelessly behind. That you may understand the importance of distinguishing between facts and mere information, study that type of man who is guided entirely by that which he hears, the type who is influenced by all the whisperings of the winds of gossip, that accepts without analysis all that he reads in the newspapers and judges others by what their enemies and competitors and contemporaries say about them. Search your circle of acquaintances and pick out one of this type as an example to keep before your mind while we are on this subject. Observe that this man usually begins his conversation with some such term as this: "I see by the papers," or "they say." The accurate thinker knows that the newspapers are not always accurate in their reports, and he also knows that what they say usually carries more falsehood than truth. If you have not risen above the "I see by the papers" and the "they say" class, you have still far to go before you become an accurate thinker. Of course, much truth and many facts travel in the guise of idle gossip and newspaper reports, but the accurate thinker will not accept as such all that he sees and hears. This is a point which I feel impelled to emphasize for the reason that it constitutes the rocks and reefs on which so many people flounder and go down to defeat in a bottomless ocean of false conclusions. In the realm of legal procedure, there is a principle which is called the law of evidence, and the object of this law is to get at the facts. Any judge can proceed with justice to all concerned if he has the facts upon which to base his judgment, but he may play havoc with innocent people if he circumvents the law of evidence and reaches a conclusion or judgment that is based upon hearsay information. The law of evidence varies according to the subject and circumstances with which it is used, but you will not go far wrong if, in the absence of that which you know to be facts, you form your judgments on the hypothesis that only that part of the evidence before you which furthers your own interests, without working any hardship on others, is based upon facts. This is a crucial and important point in this lesson. Therefore, I wish to be sure that you do not pass by it lightly. Many a man mistakes, knowingly or otherwise, expediency for fact, doing a thing or refraining from doing it for the sole reason that his action furthers his own interest without consideration as to whether it interferes with the rights of others. No matter how regrettable, it is true that most thinking of today, far from being accurate, is based upon the sole foundation of expediency. It is amazing to the more advanced student of accurate thought how many people there are who are honest when it is profitable to them, but find myriads of facts to justify themselves in following a dishonest course when that course seems to be more profitable or advantageous. No doubt you know people who are like that. The accurate thinker adopts a standard by which he guides himself, and he follows that standard at all times, whether it works always to his immediate advantage or carries him now and then through the fields of disadvantage, as it undoubtedly will. The accurate thinker deals with facts regardless of how they affect his own interests, for he knows that ultimately this policy will bring him out on top, in full possession of the object of his definite chief aim in life. He understands the soundness of the philosophy that the old philosopher Croesus had in mind when he said, "There is a wheel on which the affairs of men revolve, and its mechanism is such that it prevents any man from being always fortunate." The accurate thinker has but one standard by which he conducts himself in his intercourse with his fellow men, and that standard is observed by him as faithfully when it brings him temporary disadvantage as it is when it brings him outstanding advantage. For being an accurate thinker, he knows that by the law of averages he will more than regain at some future time that which he loses by applying his standard to his own temporary detriment. You might as well begin to prepare yourself to understand that it requires the staunchest and most unshakable character to become an accurate thinker, for you can see that this is where the reasoning of this lesson is leading. There is a certain amount of temporary penalty attached to accurate thinking. There is no denying this fact. But while it is true, it is also true that the compensating reward in the aggregate is so overwhelmingly greater that you will gladly pay this penalty. In searching for facts, it is often necessary to gather them through the sole source of knowledge and experience of others. It then becomes necessary to examine carefully both the evidence submitted and the person from whom the evidence comes. And when the evidence is of such a nature that it affects the interest of the witness who is giving it, there will be reason to scrutinize it all the more carefully, as witnesses who have an interest in the evidence that they are submitting often yield to the temptation to color and pervert it to protect that interest. If one man slanders another, his remarks should be accepted, if of any weight at all, with at least a grain of the proverbial salt of caution. For it is a common human tendency for men to find nothing but evil in those whom they do not like. The man who has attained to the degree of accurate thinking that enables him to speak of his enemy without exaggerating his faults and minimizing his virtues is the exception and not the rule. Some very able men have not yet risen above this vulgar and self-destructive habit of belittling their enemies, competitors, and contemporaries. I wish to bring this common tendency to your attention with all possible emphasis, because it is a tendency that is fatal to accurate thinking.